What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel.
In the previous video of this series, we discussed and implemented the factory method pattern. So as a follow-up, we are going to tackle today the abstract factory pattern. Therefore, if you haven't watched our previous upload or have no idea what the factory method pattern is, I suggest you take a look at the video link down below in the description first. So, the abstract factory is a creational design pattern that lets you produce families of related objects without specifying their concrete classes. You can think of it as if you were using the factory method pattern, but multiple times, or as if you were scaling up your factory to handle the creation of multiple distinct products. Okay, as usual, and to better understand the concept at hand, let's take a practical approach, and imagine you want to simulate the creation of computer parts. Now, to not overcomplicate the example right from the beginning, suppose you are just manufacturing GPUs. Now, the GPUs you are manufacturing belong to a certain brand, and the brands covered by our company are MSI and ASUS. If you've watched our factory method pattern video, you may have already noticed the analogy of this example with the restaurant one we gave back then. So let's go ahead and try to apply the factory method pattern on this example. The GPUs are our products, and to distinguish the brands we have, we can create an MSI GPU class and an ASUS GPU class. These two classes should implement a common interface or abstract product, which is the GPU interface in our case. The creator class of this example, where our business logic sits, can be seen as the whole company. Hence, the concrete creators will be the MSI manufacturer and the ASUS manufacturer classes. These two classes will implement the createGPU method, the factory method, in this case. So the MSI manufacturer class will return MSI branded GPUs, and the ASUS manufacturer class will return ASUS branded GPUs. Okay, until now all we did was apply the factory method pattern and our code is clean and nice. But when does the abstract factory come into play? When should we use it? Well, imagine that your company started to manufacture monitors on top of GPUs. And these monitors can also be MSI branded or ASUS branded. Let's try to integrate this requirement in the code we just implemented. The first thing most people will start by doing is create a different class for each concrete component or product we have. In this example, we will have the MSI GPU, the ASUS GPU, the MSI monitor, and the ASUS monitor classes. Then they'll rename the GPU interface to something broader, like component, and then let each different concrete product implement this interface. Now, all that is left to do is rename the factory method inside our company class from createGPU to createComponent, and pass the type of product we need to this method. Consequently, in our concrete creators or manufacturer classes, and with the help of the type we just added, we will be able to return the correct product requested by the user. The modifications we just did will lead to a working solution and will help us expand our company. However, the resulting code you see may change when things change. Like if we start handling new computer components, we're going to have to open this code and change it, and that violates the open-closed principle. Now, some of you may be wondering, how did this guy manage to violate the open-closed principle even though he was applying the factory method pattern? Well, you see, in this particular example, a single factory is not enough. And that is where you should start thinking about calling up your implementation from the factory method pattern to the abstract factory design pattern. To do this, let's bring back our GPU interface and create a separate interface called monitor. This interface will be implemented by the ASUS monitor and MSI monitor classes. You see, the first thing the abstract factory pattern suggests is to explicitly declare interfaces for each distinct product we have, and then make all variants of these products follow those interfaces. The next suggested move is to create inside our abstract factory, which in our case will be the company class, a list of creation methods or factory methods, one for each abstract product we have. In this example, we have two abstract products, the GPU and the monitor interfaces. Hence, we will have two factory methods. Now, each concrete factory we have, or manufacturer class in this example, will return a product or interface of a particular kind. And that is how we decouple the creation of our products from the part that is actually using it with the help of abstract factory pattern. Moreover, the users or clients of our application can now work with any concrete factory as long as it communicates with their objects via their corresponding abstract interfaces. Okay, let's go ahead now and take a look at the generalized class diagram structure of the abstract factory pattern, all while trying to relate it to our current example. The company glass here is the abstract factory itself, and this factory is implemented by concrete factories, which are the manufacturer classes in this example. Each concrete factory is responsible for creating both products, which means that both factories should and must return the same abstract product or interface. However, the concrete product created should correspond or relate to the type of factory it was created from. So to recap, you should use the abstract factory pattern when your code needs to work with various families of related products, but you don't want it to depend on the concrete classes of those products. Though they might be known beforehand, and that's why many designs start by using the factory method pattern, as it is less complicated and more customizable via subclasses, and later evolve toward an abstract factory design. By using this pattern, you will be following and applying the open-closed principle and the single responsibility principle, as you are centralizing the product creation code in one place in the program. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.